Hey everyone, I'm Felissa Rose, and you're watching Slash and Cast. Hi, I'm Felissa Rose. I played Angela in Sleepaway Camp.
You can actually, it looks exactly the same.
Bless your heart.
It's been a while, but you haven't changed at all. I think one of the interesting things about Sleepaway Camp is the fact that you were, what, 13 when you shot it and 14 when it came
13.
Out?
13.
So how did your parents feel with, like, the script and whatnot? Or did you even know auditioning for it? Or
we did. On the callback, they actually had to tell us all about the, you know, the end scene. Because they had to make sure we were okay with it. So they told my mom and my dad, and they were like, yeah, it's cool. I mean, it seemed so unique and original that I felt like it was the kind of movie that would actually grab an audience, you know?
Yeah, recently it came out about the prosthetics you had to wear, including the one for your prosthetic face, which is right here on your table.
Yes.
And, of course, the prosthetic genitalia.
Yes.
Can you talk about, like, that process a little bit and what you had to go through for that?
So, actually, we'll take this picture right here. We'll do a little show and tell. So, I was 13, and originally Ed French, the special effects artist, wanted to put a penis on me. But that didn't make much sense because I do have boobies. And they decided then to make a mask of my face and put it on an 18-year-old boy. And so the long shots are of the boy, but the close-ups are me. So we had to match.
Wow.
And that's how we did the ending.
How weird was it seeing your face on someone else?
It was very strange. I remember the first time I saw it in the movie theater. I was in ninth grade. And to see that image on screen, and they really held it there for a very long time. It was a bit disturbing and creepy, but it was also kind of wonderful because it was like, wow, that is something that's very impressionable. And I think an audience likes their horror to have something that just kind of jolts them. So it did its job.
Sleepaway Camp now is more relevant than ever, actually, so with like the whole new generation of the way people think. It's just different now.
Yeah.
Have you noticed, like, that film, despite it being you being a killer and murdering people, do you find it like that it's helped people in certain situations? Maybe, like, made more comfortable for people? I don't know how to explain it, but
I mean, you know what? It's a very provocative film.
Right.
And with a very homoerotic undertone. And I think it's sort of, you know, well, definitely bullying was a main topic that we hadn't spoken about back in the day. And I think today it's very prevalent. So it was ahead of its time with that. And also just the whole, like, you know, she was a transvestite.
Right.
And then transitioned in the sequel. So it was sort of also something that was, you know, kind of different for 1982.
Yeah.
We hadn't seen that in a horror movie yet. So I had gotten a lot of mail at the time from people who were also transitioning. And I felt very, you know, it was touching to me that people would feel like they could reach out and talk to me about it because I just played this character, but people related. So that meant a lot. It meant that I did my job. It was connecting.
Yeah. In the last, like, 8 years, you've been in a lot of films. A lot of films. Like, you pretty much are one of the top screen queens of this generation.
Aww. Oh my God! Wow.
Yeah, I mean,
you just totally, like,
it's pretty. I'd say it's pretty true. I mean,
I don't think
many people would argue that at all. So, like, what is that like? Because you've been traveling a lot too from convention. I mean, you're even here in a small area of Wheaton in the middle of
it.
A very cold fall.
I feel very grateful. I feel like, you know, you kind of set out to do something like acting or, you know, any kind of artistry, and just for people to remember something small like Sleepaway Camp gave me a life, gave me a career. So I'm very appreciative. And to be asked to do all of these conventions, it's just, I don't know, I can't explain it. Like, it's amazing. And the reason I like to do the conventions is so that I can talk to people because I'm a fan of the genre. And this is a family environment. We're all really close. I mean, everyone's sitting here right now at this table. I met at a convention, and we've developed long-lasting friendships. So it's very special to me. It means a lot.
Just last year, Victor Crowley came out. And not only, I imagine you had to work for very cheap with everyone that would just agree to help Adam with it. What was that like being able to go into a film that you knew was going to be really popular, but do it for just so cheap and helping a friend out?
If Adam Green asked me to just bring him coffee, I would do it so happily. And that was the thing. I had been a huge fan of Hatchet and Adam. So when he said, I have this role for you in Victor Crowley, I mean, truth be told, like, I just started bawling because that's a dream come true to be part of a franchise that was already established with a director I have huge love and respect for. And I love the script, and my character, I thought, was fucking amazing. I thought she was the epitome of all crazy. And to work with that cast, Perry Shen, Laura Ortiz, Dave Sheridan, Tiffany Shepis, Crystal Brown, they were all just, you know, it was a great ensemble.
Every time I see you from convention to convention, I always give you the same compliment, is that you absolutely nailed that character. It's almost like it was unbelievably natural, but you're obviously not like that at all. You're unbelievably nice. So you literally are playing opposite of yourself, and you couldn't have played it any better.
Thank you.
Now, is that your first film with Kane?
No, I had done Death House with Kane.
Oh, that's right. I guess I didn't realize it was shot
so
afterwards.
The way it was shot, right. We had done Death House, and then 6 months later, we went and did Victor Crowley. And Kane and I had been doing a lot of conventions at that time together, and obviously currently, but he's a very dear friend of mine. I was thrilled to be asked to be in his documentary. He's one of the most special people just on the planet. His heart is huge. He takes care of anybody who supports him, and I feel like I've learned a lot from him. He's been like a mentor to me. I watch how he is with all the people who come to see him at conventions, and he's very loving and embraces, you know, all of his supporters.
Yeah, I imagine that was a really cool experience in general, because so many people helped out with that film. So you were not only an icon yourself now in the genre, but you stood side by side with other people in that genre. So
it's still, like, strange to me. Being in the room with, like, Kane Hodder and Sita Haig and Tony Todd and Dee Wallace, and it's just mind-blowing, actually.
That was another film where, I don't know, I've seen the behind-the-scenes of Victor Crowley, but I don't know the prosthetic situation you went through, but you definitely have the most unique kill in that film, and I would arguably the best kill that Victor Crowley has. Everyone will argue the jaw rip, but I think your death is the most unique out of the bunch. Can you explain the process of making that kill possible?
Yeah, for me it was all about, well, they ripped the arm off. Mm-hmm. Spoilers.
Spoiler alert, sorry.
And then they had to go through, you know, had to get the head cast so that they could go through the mouth. And I mean, it wasn't very, I'm, you know, we're typically, when we make horror movies, we go through a lot of the life cast, which is dreadful. And I remember going, Tiffany Shepis sat with me. I had to take a Xanax because, you know, when you have that latex over you for like an hour.
You just can breathe out of your nose, right? Like, you just
can't. Not even. I mean, it's like barely. Oh. So you just have to go into like a very zen place. She sat and held my hand, and then they created it. And even on set, it's interesting because you, working with Kane as Victor Crowley is an incredible experience because he's so in his character that when he's chasing you to kill you, it's like, okay, and your death is up now. Everybody get ready. And it's dark and it's cold and it's raining and it's, you know, chilly. And I'm in heels and I have to run up a mountain and they're watering. Yeah, water down that mountain. I'm like, fuck you. And like, I started crying and he's poking me in the back with a stick to get me, like, you know, into it. And it's like, it's crazy. And it was so awesome in every possible way. I could say, Kane Hodder, yes, you got up my skirt and we nailed it.
Well, I guess even though you shot it before, the next film you have coming out, I think, is Death House from your upcoming projects, which will come out December 13th on VOD and DVD and Blu-ray. So, like, what was that like? Your character hasn't been talked about much, and not many people have been able to see it in theaters. It's been such select theaters. So, like, can you explain, one, what is Death House about? Is it like, is it worth seeing? Because it definitely is. And like, really, what does your character do?
So there are many characters in this film. It's definitely an ensemble piece. There's, you know, a great list of actors that participate in the film. I play an evil doctor, but I feel like my bigger role on this project is one of the producers.
You travel a lot with Harrison, right? Too?
I travel. Yeah, he's my business partner, Harrison Smith, and I work with Entertainment Factory, Rick Finkelstein. So I did Garlic and Gunpowder with them, yeah. And Stan the Man, and we just did Camp Twilight and Killer Rose. So I've done a bunch of projects with them in the past 6 months. And, you know, she was just crazy and evil. And it's a cool scene because we have amazing characters in that scene and it explains a lot about the story. But it was really fun also producing and sort of getting all of the actors together. I was part of the LA unit and it was just fun to see everyone come together for the love of Gunnar. Gunnar Hansen.
So you stepping in and out of acting role and a producing role, what is that experience like? Because producing is, a lot of people don't realize just how stressful producing is.
Producing is fucking hard, you know? It's like, it's taken me a long time to even understand what a producer really does. I mean, we're like the soup to nuts person. We sometimes bring the script, the director, the crew, the locations, the cast. You're the everything person. You're sort of like the wedding planner. For the wedding, or the mom to 1,000 children. Somebody's crying. Somebody's hungry. Somebody needs a hug. Somebody fucking lost their costume. Somebody's, you know, mad about not having enough, you know, food on set. So you're sort of in charge of making everything go right.
Right. Okay, so I'll just ask one more question so I
get
out of your way and
no
everyone,
worries.
We're not
I
blocking
it.
Everyone anymore.
I appreciate it.
We usually always try to ask people on our last question a really hard thing to answer. It's really like... wide range you can do here, but since you've pretty much taken over the horror genre, you've been kind of specializing in horror, and now you're part of a pretty big franchise with Hatchet. If you could pick one franchise to join in on a sequel and act in that sequel or produce it, or either or, if you have one you'd rather produce and one rather act in, what franchise would that be?
That's a difficult question. because I'm a huge fan myself. And everything's going through my mind, like Halloween, Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street, Texas Chainsaw Massacre. But if I really had to choose one that I sort of, you know, immersed myself in, I think it would have to be Texas Chainsaw Massacre because I've been in love with the original since I'm real young. And I would love to see something unique and outside of the box with it. And I'm in love with all of the characters and everything about it.